Hello, good morning everybody. Welcome to this session on the uptake of AI in the public sector. My name is Annemarie Sassen and I am the Deputy Head of Unit of DigiConnect Unit A2, Technologies and Systems for Digitizing Industry. As we all know, AI can greatly contribute to better public services. It can improve efficiency, decision-making, and also the interaction between citizens and their government. In this session, we will see several examples of how countries are already piloting with AI. We will also try to get answers to the challenges related to scaling up these pilots to real use in an administration. The conclusions that we will reach in this session will be used by the European Commission to develop an adopt AI program, which was mentioned in the white paper as a means to support public procurement of AI systems and to accelerate the uptake of AI in the public sector. Gianluca, can you please share your presentation already and go to the second slide?
Yes, I think the presentation is on the screen.
I see the presentation. Thank you.
Okay.
And then, yes, I want to first ask you all to connect to Slido with the hashtag AI Alliance. And then you should choose the session B3, uptake of AI in the public sector. We created two questions for you, which you can respond. And you can also formulate your own questions that you would like to ask to the panelists. At the end of this session, we will have 15 minutes foreseen to start answering your questions. Now, I would like to introduce you to the speakers in today's session. We will be starting with Gianluca Misuraca. He's a former researcher at the Joint Research Center. And currently he's working at the Department for E-Governance and Public Administration, the Danube University in Krems in Austria. He will provide us with an overview of the AI Watch study, which studied the uptake of AI in the public sector in Europe. He conducted this study while he was working for the Joint Research Center. After his introduction, we will hear the experience of managers in public administrations. We have three countries: the Netherlands, Spain, and Latvia. All these countries have more than 12 different cases where they already used artificial intelligence. And I'm very happy that we can learn from them today. So our speakers will be Marieke van Putten, Senior Innovation Manager at the Dutch Ministry of the Interior and Kingdom Relations. She has previous experience in innovation procurement and is now part of the program team of the Netherlands AI Coalition, focusing on the public sector. Our second speaker will be Lucia Velasco-Jones. She's the director of the cabinet of the Spanish Secretary of State for Digitalization and Artificial Intelligence. And our third speaker will be Gatis Ozols, head of the Public Services Department at the Latvian Ministry of Environmental Protection and Regional Development. And he's responsible for digital government and public service digital transformation policy in Latvia. So with this introduction, Gianluca, I now want to hand over to you to give us the overview of the uptake of AI in the public sector.
Thank you, Anne-Marie, and good morning, everyone. Very glad to be here, and I hope you hear me well, and you see the slide. So as Anne-Marie anticipated, I will present some of the key findings and issues that emerge from the studies I've been coordinating while in fact working at the European Commission Joint Research Center on the overview of the use and impact of AI. This is part of the study, as Anne-Marie said, of the work that is conducted by the DigiConnect in cooperation with the Joint Research Center at the AI Watch, the service to monitor the development uptake and the impact of AI in and for Europe. And in particular, the task I've been leading was on AI for the public sector. Now, the objectives were to make a first overview of what is the use of AI in public services in the EU member states, and start developing a methodology to assess impacts and that would lead to a roadmap and framework for use of AI in public services. So this is this has been done in the first year of operation with a number of activities, including peer learning, starting a peer learning process with member states that before the pandemic started and now will continue, of course, online. Now, without entering too much into, let's say, the conceptualization part, but here we really looked at the adoption and use of AI and how innovation can be enabled by artificial intelligence. Having a functional view of this technology, or better, set of technology, and then we, for this reason, we derived a specific typology from the collected cases that, of course, is flexible enough to be changed over time. As at the moment, we have. Gathered the first set of 230 cases across the EU member states, plus Switzerland, Norway, and UK that are documented in a report published in June. Clearly, this is, let's say, a picture that is biased by many reasons, and in particular by the fact that we need to go much more in depth, and especially going to the local level. In fact, if we see the key findings of this first overview is that the moment, I mean, we use a classic the COFO classification of function of the government, we see that most of the initiative we have collected in our database is focusing on the general public services, almost a third of the data set, on health and economic affairs in general. And most of these cases, in fact, are at the national level. But we have a 30% of initiatives that are already in our sample addressing the local municipal level, but we believe that there is much more that need to be digged in from the analysis. In terms of technology, because of course we all recognize the transformative potential of AI, and especially when it is different approaches are combined between them. But at the moment, we still see quite a prevalence of, let's say, single use and traditional technology, not so sophisticated, like chatbot, predictive analytics, a bit of expert rule-based systems and image recognition, for instance. But still, we don't see much, at least in the analysis we have done, such a transformative, disruptive change, organizational reforms that are enabled by the technology. So there are many challenges still in moving from the data analysis that is yet much developed, but to how really adopt this technology and how pilot solutions are really institutionalized. Now, if we look at from another perspective at the purpose, so why member state, why in public sector are adopting the technology, AI technologies, and we adopted a framework developed for a study from the US, for the US Congress, we see that most of the initiative in our sample, almost 40% exactly, aim to support the service provision, also somehow citizen engagement through chatbot or matching services, for instance, for unemployment or social services. But there are only 20% each in the category of enforcement, so detecting fraud or ensuring real compliance to regulation, or for internal management, so like ICT or business process or engineering, if you want. And finally, there are some 70% on support to decision making and analysis, and only 5%, at least in our sample, are really, focusing on the entitlement and benefit granting. Now, if we look from another perspective, of course, these are just a snapshot of the analysis we have done. We try to look at what is the value added and created by these kind of initiatives. And we see at the moment, according to a basic framework, most of the initiatives are clearly looking at increasing and improving the performance of public services and internal government operations. And there is a less focus, at least for the time being, on opening up and more inclusive services. But of course, this is the aim of most initiatives, especially in their potential perspective. Now, I won't go again in detail, but clearly, if we look from an innovation perspective, we see that most initiatives are at the moment looking at single organizational process redesign. These are not necessarily in a, let's say, changing organizational structure. That is something that instead many other AI enabled processes like robotic process automation or even chatbots combined with across, let's say, different back office streams can implement. Or and there are still less disruptive or radical innovation that are by the way, very much, let's say, possible and on the planet phase at the moment in many member states. Now, as I said, we also make as complementary to another specific task of the iWatch that look at the monitoring the national AI strategies in their comprehensive approach. We have been focusing on the public sector. And here again, well, we only looked at the strategies that were at the time of the analysis published and available in English, so 13. But at the moment, we also see that there is a further development and focus on, you know, the use and the adoption of AI for the public sector in other strategies. But in general, at the moment, we have seen that there is mainly, let's say, initiatives to stimulate awareness and sharing knowledge, strengthening data management, building internal capacity is often through learning by doing, and also there is focus, of course, on the ethical aspects, but also procurement and GovTech is an important element. Now, in terms of comparison, it's difficult to make really a comparison and an analysis that is somehow take into consideration all the nuances and the differences. But there are many differences and some uncertainty of what is the degree of contribution of AI to adopt AI of these actions, with a clear focus on data access and quality and initiatives to stimulate or facilitate adoption. There is a bit less of, let's say, dedicated funding or legal reforms. I mean, if we want to use a metaphor that we use in public policy analysis, basically there are quite a lot of sermons, so and less, let's say, sticks and carrots at the moment. So there is probably the need to define better some intervention that integrate incentives and, of course, rules for adoption. So just coming to the end, clearly there are many open issues still, and that's good. The good part of doing research, because there are future research directions and questions to look at. But clearly also in terms of implication for policymakers, we see a quite high level of heterogeneity of AI use, and still not clear what is the value that is created in many cases. So still the search for, let's say, the holy grail or the best practice that we can learn from and replicate or transfer out is still much needed. But this goes through the need to institutionalize such technology into mainstream services beyond the paradox of ever piloting that sometimes it can be a barrier to real use and adoption of technology. We also seen that there is little evidence of what really works and what is actually a threat, a risk for service quality. And in terms of national strategy, we are seeing there are differences in depth, and it's very important to consider the dual or even triple role of a public sector in the governance with and of AI, but also the algorithmic governance of governance by AI. And as I said, and I believe this will be part of the discussion, now the public procurement, the GovTech is an important component to be experimented. Just to conclude, the four main takeaways. One is that there is a growing interest on the use of AI in the public sector to redesign internal processes, but also to improve the service delivery. And member states, all member states, are actually exploring the use of AI in the public sector. So there is, however, still a bit of an imbalance between the transformative potential and the effective adoption. And then more from a methodological perspective, clearly we need to develop, let's say, a benchmark for exchanging practices and the methodology to assess impact. And just to conclude, I believe that the common approach among member states would be, again, game changer for AI adoption in the public sector. And this probably would be food for the thought for the discussion. And so if there's any specific question, I would be then glad to enter into the debate. But otherwise, I thank you. And thanks again for the invitation.
Thank you very much, Gianluca, for this very comprehensive and interesting overview. I would like now to ask to Gatis if you can tell us where you are using AI in Latvia, and also what were your main reasons for deciding to use AI?
Okay, thank you. As we try to sometimes say in Latvia, we are not a small, but we are compact and agile country, so we have to use technologies instead of people to make things work. So in Latvia, we one of the ways how we look, of course, is again efficiency, but it's the first application of this AI. Afterwards, then comes the more higher level benefits. But starting from some examples from Latvia, I could distribute it in several levels. The first level, of course, is organizational level, and there are examples where we try to improve the capacity or automation of the administrative institutions. And some examples are that we are working on implementation of text analysis to enable automatic case handling of incoming documents, for example, within institutions. So it's a very narrow, but still it's allows administrations to become more efficient in their work. Then the focus area for Latvia, as we are the country with pretty small, we can call it like one of the small languages, but if we look at in European context, there is 24 official languages in Europe, and there are more than 80 of languages spoken. And according to some data, some years ago, it was made it only a little bit more like than a half of the citizens. They use only their native language for communication in digital environment. So this multilinguality of the digital environment was and still is one of the priorities for Latvia, and where we use technologies and develop technologies. So we work on those machine translation and natural language processing tools to enable this multilingual communication within our country between different citizen groups from coming with different languages, and of course to enable for our citizens to participate fully in the digital single market and in cross-border business activities. So for this reason, we have implemented a national machine translation platform, which is called Hugo. It is used by public administrations. It's integrated in our national portal and different websites, which provides this automatic translation from Latvian to English or other languages. And this is a tool is also provided as a free to use for all the citizens and businesses in the country. So we from the government side have developed this language kind of platform, but now it's been open for everyone to be used. And we hope that it will increase this multilinguality of our environment. And upon this, we have developed the next kind of level of these language technologies, which have allowed us this use of more complex applications like text-to-speech and speech recognition tools, which are very helpful also to solve the accessibility issues for different groups of citizens, also to increase efficiency of government work, as it allows, for example, to provide automatic transcription of parliament sittings or on municipal sittings into written form, and also increase this accessibility of the content. And then building upon that, we have developed also the chatbots and chatbot platform for our government. And here we are speaking not only about some individual chatbots for specific organizations. Of course, the first one was our company Register, who created the chatbot, but now we've developed a government-wide platform, which is available for any government or municipal institution, where they don't need to care about some technical things, but they can take care only about the content and training of those chatbots. And it is provided as a shared service for all the general administration, municipal administration institutions. And now we are at the final phase of this project, and there are already some, I think 10 or more than 10 the chatbots developed on this platform. And of course, applications are different, and we see that, for example, in company register, it was reported that some 44% of the incoming calls could be solved with help of the chatbot, with automatic processing of those. So we see the reduction of load of the workers on the like very kind of those simple tasks, and then we can focus on more complex tasks. In the end, there are some examples where we use also in to ensure the road safety, image recognition in speed cameras that has allowed us to reduce the casualties by 43% in the areas we have put these speed cameras. And of course, also in health sector, there are some tools that have allowed the better detection of melanoma in screening procedures. So these are some areas we've been using.
Thank you, Gatis. I think this is very impressive. And you also see how the specificities of a country can lead to a certain specialization in a country, like in your case, the natural language processing through which you can do all kinds of, chatbots, you can improve efficiency, you can also make services more accessible for all the citizens. And I think that's very interesting to see. I would like
the main thing is that we can do it in our own language.
Yes, now you can, from now on, you can work in your own language and then transport all of that to the rest of the world. Yeah, that's very good. And I also know that you contributed your language technology also to the European Commission, so that it's also available for all European citizens who would like to do business with Latvian businesses, for instance. Yes. So I think that's
really, it's integrated with translation tool of the European Commission.
Yeah, so that's really very good. I would like now to turn to Marieke and ask her the same question. Can you tell us where in the Netherlands you are using AI at the moment?
Yeah, the Netherlands uses AI in a variety of sectors. And of course, we also have our unique selling point, which is usually public space, roads, and water. AI has been used by the Netherlands Food Authority, very interesting for their inspection and maybe also law enforcement. They have been using data and drones for quite a number of years, and they, of course, they added AI to it to detect diseases. And that's an example where the whole organization might change due to these new instruments. It's also been used similar to Latvia in public services, direct client contact to allow them to have 24/7 services, and they use chatbots and hybrid systems. It's also been used to optimize resources in maintenance of public space. And this is really sensitive. We're also using it in a very, very small extent, and are still experimenting in the social domain to detect poverty and to prevent deaths. We do this in cooperation with the Netherlands Artificial Intelligence Coalition, which is a public-private coalition also focusing on the public sector. And those are some areas where we use it.
Okay, thank you very much. Lucia, can you tell us the situation in Spain? Are you already using AI?
Sure, we have found that we are using in Spain in different areas AI. Probably some of them are very similar to the ones already mentioned. But one of the things that we see mainly two things. One is that the pandemic has boosted the use or the interest for using AI from a public administration perspective, which is something that we, of course, need to build on. And this has been the case for more recent developments, which were a chatbot in the middle of the pandemic, where a lot of infodemy and disinformation was floating around, and we used that way to communicate trustworthy information to the citizens who were completely confused and not that familiar with doing searches and going to trustworthy sources of information. On the other hand, we have also launched a program with several hospitals and the Barcelona Supercomputer Center to work to elaborate a model to predict the evolution of COVID-19 patients based on the information that more than 3,000 clinical reports have been generated. And so that is one clear example of how you can use AI for immediate action in a situation like the one we are all suffering. This said, we all know the public administration has a vital role in the development and uptake of our artificial intelligence. However, and I know that this is probably not the most innovative thing to share, but usually you have a lot of initiatives and there's sort of a rush to, you know, communicate what you're doing, but we have decided to take a step back and understand what is being done from where and for what. And that starts from making sense about the organization, on the structure of the government. So when the new government took office 8 months ago or 9 months ago, the first step was to create a vice presidency of economic affairs and digital transformation. And so digital transformation won't be a box lost somewhere down in the structure, but will be at the head of the government and the economic vice president level. Also, the Secretary of State was created for the first time, called Digitalization and Artificial Intelligence, showing the importance that we recognize to this technology. At the same time, for the first first, the Digital Administration Secretary General was moved in dependent below the Secretary of State. So everything is linked and aligned, and we are all thinking together what we are going to do as a country. And the next phase was to issue a digital agenda for Spain, where it has a clear focus on the digital transformation of the public sector in order to include this technology. And under this digital agenda are the national strategy for AI, the national strategy for digital government, and the data office, as well as the National Advisory Board on Artificial Intelligence. So this way you have a complete setup in order to tackle this challenge that we have with artificial intelligence. I will stop here in case that we can continue later.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, so I hear that Spain is really reorganizing its own governmental structure to make sure that the whole country can take benefit from the digital transformation, and that everything is also done in an, an orderly way and structured, so that it will have real effects and it will not be just the, I don't mean it so strict like that, the individual little pilots that come out, but that you think as a whole how to take benefit of this. So that also sounds very good. So I would like maybe to move to Marieke and ask, what do you think are now the main challenges faced in the public procurement of AI systems? And yeah, I know you have been involved in pre-commercial procurement, and that could be a best practice. And I would like to invite you to talk about that a little bit. You have to unmute yourself.
I did that, you know, you don't want to interfere with others. Yeah, we actually have the same as Spain. We have a system in place where we want to challenge companies and try to change organization and also implement it. And since AI hasn't been uptaken by a lot of organizations, we used actually pre-commercial procurement in a twofold way. First, of course, to stimulate SMEs, innovative SMEs, to come up with solutions for societal challenges tackled by the government. And you see that in a lot of cases, the connections are there, they are in place, but not leading to projects most of the time. And I think the pre-commercial procurement really bridges that gap, you know, from a basic idea to really do a feasibility study and maybe in the second phase develop a prototype. But it also changes organizations. And what we saw, we have done so far two pre-commercial procurements basically in AI. And the first one was really broad. We did it with the Ministry of Justice and Safety. And it was on AI in the public sector. And what we saw was a large variety of solutions, but also many different organizations that were involved, ranging from the Food Authority to our Land Registry Office, which is not known to be really innovative. And when they presented their ideas in the second phase, when they had done the feasibility studies, we were really surprised, because it was very much a low threshold solution. And many organizations were stimulated to take up AI to convince the people in their own organization to change. And that was really an outcome that we didn't expect in this way. And some of the experts were really enthusiastic. So I really believe that in innovation procurement, you need a variety of instruments, starting with meeting each other in market dialogues, but then, you know, really learning by doing in pre-commercial procurement. And of course, I totally agree with Spain and Latvia. You really have to stimulate it from the first beginning to implementation, but that's a different issue. But I think pre-commercial procurement is a really powerful tool to boost the enthusiasm, rather than just guidelines and papers and presentations.
Yeah, so push the enthusiasm and the also the innovation, the surprises that you get because of that work through the pre-commercial procurement. That's something that we should remember. Gatis, I also know that you also have some best practices to share in overcoming some of the challenges involved in AI procurement. I think you organized also a hackathon in Latvia to bring about these results. Can you please elaborate on that?
Yeah, thank you. And yeah, as it was mentioned, I think one of the main challenges currently for public administration is to become knowledgeable or educated procurer, and sometimes public administrations it's hard to formulate a procurement. So it's a great role and importance to have these pre-procurement possibilities where public administrations in cooperation with private sector, with NGOs, can model, can test, and can formulate actually the potential options and potential subjects for the afterwards procurement. And in Latvia, we have had several examples how we try to tackle it. There were some initiated from municipality side on more like a regional level as well, and some were initiated from business and from NGO side. The one from NGO side and for our business side was a kind of a challenge for public institutions, where they could come up with challenges they would like to solve. And these challenges were given for some several teams, which were accompanied by experts, by individuals from companies, from NGOs, and to provide the potential options for the solution. For example, one of such cases where our court administration wanted to know whether it's possible to create a kind of system or model where they could predict the lengths of the court procedure depending on the type of the application, probably the judge or some other aspects. And the idea was when I apply for a court, it could give already me some estimation on what could be the length, potential length of this court case. So there were several teams competing on providing some and creating some models, and actually it was a very successful like a case study, which allowed then for court administration to formulate their next kind of phase and go also for already for some procuring activities. So I think this was important not only for this court case, but as it was made as a public event and where different administrations could come and share and have this also networking, it provided some kind of encouragement also for other institutions to work in such kind of manner. The other example was from our one of the municipalities. One of municipalities have formulated their like selling point is to become more like this ICT related or with like in this intellectual kind of digital like specialization, and they had some program on this, and one of the parts of the program was a hackathon for municipalities and for institutions regarding use of data and use of artificial intelligence and data analytics for different needs of the municipalities. And during those hackathons, there were some ideas identified and the experts worked on. But what was done in addition to that, to getting around the ideas, was that afterwards, the municipalities were formulated a list of data which are needed for some specific needs, and they worked on to open those data for innovation and for development of those prototypes. And the other aspect that was done within this program that there was provided training for municipality workers, for municipality employees on data analytics, on artificial intelligence, just to also increase their skills, knowledge, and capacity to work in this field. So from our experience, it is very important to have also this skills increasing improvement programs and in collaboration with also those pre-procurement activities.
Yeah, thank you very much, Tati. So now we've heard that it's very important to stimulate the imagination of everybody on what AI can do, and two ways of doing that is, for instance, the hackathons that are organized in Latvia, or the pre-commercial procurement, which is then organized in the Netherlands. And through this, you can have a testing approach, you can have a learning approach, you can slowly learn what works, what doesn't work. And something very important which Katis also mentioned is that, of course, to make this work, the government should also make data available for companies to let their AI algorithms learn from this data and invent possible solutions, which then could be used by the government. So Lucia, now I wanted to turn to you. I don't know if you have an additional best practice to mention, but otherwise I would like to ask, what do you think, what would be the areas of a public administration where AI-enabled services would bring most value in the public sector? What is Spain thinking, you know, in your digital agenda? Do you make a preference for certain domains or situations where you think AI can play a role?
Well, we're about to issue in the next month the national strategy for artificial intelligence, where our bet is done on what this be. But I think that every country needs to understand its own reality. So at the beginning, you will probably need to take a survey or analyze the processes where AI can improve in a more impactful way the citizens, the relationship with citizens and the service delivery. At the end is what the public administration mostly does, and where the citizen has a relationship with us. So I think that it in that side, in the side of the relationship with the citizen, it's pretty relevant and easy to implement, because this will enable to give some easiness in the way that the citizens get information from the government. As we grow, as we have more and more websites, more and more places where the information is spread all around, you need to have some assistance or some assistance in the way that you are navigating through all this information and processes and access to the government. On the other side, I think as well that it's important to inform decision making by the data that you can gather and that you can take from the use of AI. Of course, to reduce bureaucracy, this is key. I mean, it's a worst problem we face, and it's the one that we need to tackle first, because it's against efficiency and any other possible economic indicator that you have. And also, I think it's very important to boost innovation in the way we do things. And that is why we're going to create a GovTech lab in order to improve or to encourage entrepreneurship around innovation in the public services. We do not want the people to think that this is something about others, but that it's about us, and that the entrepreneurial system and ecosystem needs also to help us improve the way we do things. And so yeah, to me that would be the most relevant elements. But also I would like to mention how important, and Gary said it before, it's to change the mindsets and to have the public servants and the people that are working in these environments to understand what is that we're talking about, because it's a very innovative area where very few people taking decisions are know about. So it's very it's a natural human thing to not embrace something that you don't know. So
yeah,
that's one of the key elements, having people that understand what we're talking about, and at the same time generate trust, and probably by trust, how can you generate trust and transmit that you're not doing anything shady or anything to, you know, surveil people, but working for improving their lives is through transparency. And I think that maybe Marike can share some examples from her country, but that's one of the most important elements. We need to be completely transparent and have norms in how we are going. We have to agree on norms about the use of AI in the public sector.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Can I answer?
Yeah.
Please. Yeah, because I totally agree. I think human-centric AI, as we call it, is really important. And it starts, of course, with doing the right models and paying attention in developing AI. And just like you said, too, I really believe that the mindset and the organizational structure around it is vital, because that's really where you interact with people. What we actually did in the Netherlands on AI is developing a letter to Parliament, and it was very much focusing on human rights. And if you take human rights into account, autonomy, non-discrimination, the right to be heard, all those principles, you really can relate them to what you have to do in an organization and to give people some trust.
Because if you make a mistake in an AI model, you might do it when it's implemented. You don't do it once, but you do it 100 times. And if you don't have a feedback loop, if you don't have the knowledge and the interaction with people, then that's where it really goes wrong. And if you have it embedded, and if it's really part of what you're doing, part of your process, then it works. So I very much agree with you that transparency and using it the right way comes along with the organization that understands innovation, but also understands the effect it has on people.
Yeah, thank you. So what I already observe here is that Latvia, the Netherlands and Spain are learning from each other, from the examples that you've brought and your approaches. So with my next question, I also want to go to the, let's say, to the European level and then to this Adopt AI program that we want to develop. Would you have any tips on or what would you like to see part of this Adopt AI program? What is it, what you would like, what would help you in your own country to develop the uptake of AI and the things that you would need maybe to learn from other countries? How could we set up such a program? What are the elements that should be part of such a program? So Gatis, can you very briefly, because I also want to leave some time for the audience to ask the question, can you very briefly give some points which you think should be part of a European Adopt AI program?
Thank you. Yeah, just a couple of ideas. And as we are in the initial phase of this adoption of AI in different aspects of public, and not only in public but also in more wider scope, then I think the one of important aspects is what we are doing currently right now is this peer learning, and peer learning across the borders and peer learning across the and sharing experience, what works, what doesn't work, and how could different things could be approached in nationally. And I think this is one of the ways how we could develop and increase the speed of adoption of AI. Because initially you need the kind of a friendly shoulder or friendly hand which hits on your shoulder, which helps you and assists you in the first steps. Afterwards, you are more free to be creative with different implementation, but for the first steps it's important, and I think peer learning is a good way how to do it. Now in cooperation with that, it's also of course focused.
I am losing
how to support and develop competence and capacity, those aspects.
Yeah. No. Okay, thank you very much, Gatis. Your line is getting a bit bad, so I want to turn now to Lucia. What would Spain like to see in an Adopt AI program, and how can Europe help then also the acceleration of the uptake of AI in Spain?
Well, I would say that, for example, let's try not to do all the same one time over the other. If we are developing a chatbot, why don't we just, you know, share the whole system with all the countries? Like here you have the pack to do your chatbot and you just need to, you know, add the whatever you wanted to say. But it's like, let's try to combine our efforts in a way. Also, I think that it would be super helpful to have some sort of guidelines on generate trust, as I was saying before, things that cannot be done probably at a first stage. If you are you will probably be in different stages, and if you're an early adopter of AI, you cannot put AI to take decisions over people. You know, it's like let's get a more phase oriented deployment of AI if you're going to start that journey. I also think that It should be consistent across the country and desirably across countries. Things that need to be checked to avoid bias, to avoid, as Marike was saying before, feedback loops, how can you, who is responsible of what, transparency, who is using what, a central place where all the algorithms or any other technology that is used can be found, that the data is known. I mean, this baseline in order to have a consistent approach towards using AI.
Okay, thank you. And Marike?
Yeah.
Very briefly, you, what would be your expectations of a European Adopt AI program?
In addition to what has already been mentioned, the learning experiences and setting up cross-border use cases, I really believe in that. It would also be great to have some networking activities, because it's if you want to do it, it's important that you know in different sectors what you are doing. And that's so that you can find each other when there are calls from the European Commission. I also believe in developing online tools. It could be AI impact assessment, but it could also be tools on how to use the different innovation procurement methods. And also how to set up, because Gianluca said it in his presentation, we do have experimentation and learning by doing is still very important. But if you want to scale up, it's not just a matter of having more clients, but it's also that there is an organizational awareness, how to do it, how can we change it? And I think to have that in place is also an important factor. And the other one, that's my final one, because there are many more, is data platforms. It was already mentioned too, exchange on public and even private data, if you look at fields like mobility, are really crucial too. So those prerequisites has to be paid attention to.
Yeah, okay. Thank you very much for this interesting discussion. Now I would like to look at the questions of the audience. So Julia, could you share the Slido questions? Yeah. Okay, so what we see here is the result of the poll. And the question was, what are the main challenges faced in the public procurement of AI systems? So what I see appear as the highest is transparency. So that is not something that we've heard already during the panel discussion that we had, but people want that all this happens if we do procurement, that we can do it in a very transparent way, and that everybody who would like to be involved can be involved, I suppose. Then I see as a second bigot, I see trust. So this we did raise a little bit during the panel discussion. We need to build trust. Lucia said it several times also. And Marike, how to build this trust. I think Marike said also, if we have a learning approach and we learn slowly how to do things better and we scale up, and then we have the right feedback processes also in place, so that whenever something goes wrong with the AI, it takes a wrong decision, it can be detected and it can be repaired. And so that we never take the system as an absolute system, but that all the time we make sure that it, it can be improved. Then maybe Julia, can you show the questions that were raised by the audience? So the questions, Julia, that the people asked. So I see one question, and that is, I think we already addressed it a little bit. How to ensure real human control for the administrative decisions based on algorithms? And how to ensure that data will be clean, that it will be bias-free, that will feed the algorithms? So is there any one of you who would like to respond to this question? Yeah, okay, Lucia.
Okay, I think it's a very good question, and as I was mentioning a little bit earlier, I think that we cannot or we shouldn't be allowing algorithms to take decisions over people, at least not at this initial stage. You will need to probably run many tests and test with an SI perspective, with you know, how does it work when the system takes the decision, and how does it work and a human controlling the system while it takes the decision and being able to alter or correct the decisions when they are not well made, in order to understand if the system is good enough. So that will take for sure time, and as also it was previously mentioned, the data infrastructure, it's key, and that is why we should be talking about data spaces and national data offices and sharing knowledge on this topic and working together as a union, of course, but without the data. So it's, you know, they're so linked one to the other that they're built-in blocks that we need to work on at the same time. But for sure, AI has another uses that are impactful and helpful and that can be put into practice right away before the decision making over people.
Okay, thank you for that. Then I have a second question, and that is, how are you ensuring that public AI innovation is happening in a way that's fully compliant with the EU's fundamental rights rules? Maybe, yeah. Marike, do you want to answer that one?
Sure. I think both for the public and the private sector, it's really crucial to keep fundamental rights in place. Of course, the public sector, I think, should be leading in this, because it's our competitive edge. How to make sure? It plays a different role in different areas. If you are in the social domain, it's even more crucial than if it is the maintenance of roads, which are pretty crucial too. And how do you make sure that it's in place? First of all, to build the good models, the right model, with the reliable data, which has been questioned in the one before, and also embedding it in the organization. What we do in the Netherlands, and I think that's crucial, besides that we're learning by doing, we are also developing instruments to make sure that you do it, like AI impact assessments, different codes on children's rights, for examples, and to develop that continuously and to make sure that you use it. And what we also say is that we were talking about it earlier too. You have ICT people, you have people in procurement, you have people that have knowledge and understanding of the different processes and the interaction with people. And we all have to become a bit more generic. And if we're all a bit more generic, then we take human rights into account. So you're not just responsible for a system, or you're not just responsible for the issue. It has to be integrated. And I think AI, more than ever, asks for a sound, integrated solution.
Okay, thank you very much. Then there is a question that maybe Gianluca can answer, because not the whole audience is expert on procurement, and they would like to know what is the difference between normal procurement and pre-commercial procurement. Can you very briefly explain that, Gianluca?
Well, yes, well, briefly is, okay, basically the idea to have, you know, a partnership between the private sector and the public sector before starting into the procurement process, I think is the idea behind the fact that there is a common approach, a joint approach and development also of the procurement process. And so that is not just tendering and the public sector, the funding agency, the funding actor.
Okay, thank you. Well, I know that some of the panelists need to leave now, because still, for instance, in Spain, the problems with COVID are still very, very big, and Lucia needs to work on that again. So Lucia, I think you should then just leave, because that's very important. And I want to thank you very much for your contribution to this panel and the time that you have spent with us. I will look once more in the whether there is one other question. So there is a question which maybe Gatis would like to answer. Should we open source the code of AI used in and procured by the public sector? This would increase transparency and might spark innovation. Gatis, would you like to comment on that?
Yes, thank you. We have had a discussion on that here in Latvia, and it in generally we are approaching as to artificial intelligence as it's to us the technologies we procure in government that regarding artificial intelligence, there might be some aspects.
Your line is very bad, and unfortunately we cannot hear you. So I suggest that we don't answer this question then anymore. But I would like to conclude the session, because we are also at the end of the time of the session, which was foreseen for it. And I think that we have seen that AI in the public sector, it's starting to get used. It's still, it are islands of, applications which have potential, but they've not come yet to their full potential. For that, we need an organizational change, and we really need to embed it in the organization and also understand better how to use it and how to make it trusted. We've seen that the public very much emphasizes the need for trusted AI, for AI which is not biased, which is transparent. We've seen all those words in the comments from our listeners today. And I've also seen that for all the countries, it would be very useful if we have this Adopt AI program, and we can learn from each other. You can share better the applications that are developed somewhere and transfer them to other countries where they could also be used. And that also, all together, we get the right learning and the right skills to really make this next step where we can adopt AI at a large scale in our public procurement, in our public sector systems, because the potential, as we've seen from all your examples, is really very big. So with this, I want to thank all the speakers for their interesting insights, Gianluca for the good introduction to the topic, and then also the audience for the questions that you've asked. And now I wish you all a good lunch and a good continuation of the conference this afternoon. Thank you very much.
Thank you.